My name is Joseph Pizzella. I'm the co-chair of the Waterloo Hall of Fame Committee. Our first induction was July 3rd, 1993. This is our 24th such meeting. We were the first school in the Finger Lakes to adopt a Hall of Fame. And we continue to do that and hope that we can continue to prosper and honor all the people past successes at Waterloo. The protocol tonight is simple. Tonight we're going to honor five individuals. We have a key member of the 1962 undefeated football team that went on to excel in college and then a long illustrious coaching career in the state of Florida. I welcome Paul Wagner and all the representatives of Lou Ferrelli back to Waterloo today. And we also wish him the best of health as he recovers from his surgery, the heart attack, which he had last week. But he's doing well, and we're very happy to hear that. You'll also hear from a man who set many golf records at Waterloo from 1999 to 2002. Excelled at St. John Fisher College and in many amateur tournaments. Mike Stackus, we welcome you and your family. Josh Mateo brings a huge following. The three-sport high school athlete excelled at Waterloo up to graduation in 2007. He took his talents to Elkhart State, now resides back in Waterloo. We welcome all the Mateos. Later we will hear from all-sports women's star Courtney Lincoln, who was a top athlete during the same period that Josh was there. Courtney is most noted for her career in basketball and softball. We look forward to hearing from her. And the final individual will be Coach Tim Lincoln of Waterloo Girls Basketball. He had a long and noted career as a coach here, not only as a head basketball coach, and you'll hear later some of the other responsibilities Tim had and has done for the Waterloo Central School District. The biggest change to our Hall of Fame came in 2012, where we began inducting teams. We were one of the last Hall of Fames to put teams in. We tried to get a system, and we tried to do what we think is the best we can in spreading it out amongst all sports. Our very first team was that 1962 Wayne Finger Lakes undefeated football team, which ended Miners' 11-year stretch over Waterloo. That series over 62 years is now dominated by Waterloo. Tonight we honor the 63, 64, and 65 Section 5 boys basketball record-setting champions of that era, and still in Waterloo history, the era. We welcome players and former members accepting on those who are no longer with us. We also honor our third female team, the 1980 Section 5 cross-country team, which won many sectionals, but also finished fourth in Class B in the New York State races, the highest ever attained by a Waterloo team. I got a couple of, I got one guest I want to introduce. She's here tonight. And that's our school's athletic director. They're very supportive of us, Crystal Kent. Would you stand up, please? Yes, now I see him. He's back there. And the former high school principal of Waterloo High School, and he really helped a great deal in orchestrating the Ferrelli team to get here, and that's Mike Ferrara. He's back there. Our Hall of Fame committee, made up of a cast of different people, but first of all, some of you might remember playing going against this guy when he went into sales, but he ended up teaching for over 35 years in coaching. And Tom Benetti is on our Hall of Fame committee. He's sitting over there. And he used to take pride in being there. I'm not sure. Also, Don Moretti, Chuck Nightingale, Jim Mariano. You saw Ed Courtney greeting everybody when he was here. David Pollock, Stacey Evans, and Adam McMahon. You'll all hear from later. And the co-chair with me is Timmy Lincoln. So that's our committee. And I thank them for all their work. I ask you to note two things on the table. You have your programs. And on those of you from the 63, 64, 65 theme, I went back to my roots, and I put together a little scrapbook for you of some of the articles, not only from some of the stuff I saved when I was a elementary school ball boy for you, okay? But also from Mrs. Carey, who sent me all three scrapbooks, and make sure you take a look at them. That's what Barb put together. And her heart's with you tonight. She couldn't be here, but she knows this thing's going on. So, so we'll get started. We'll bow our heads. We'll do a little invocation. Dear God, we ask you to bless all of those present at this dinner. We honor the inductees to our Hall of Fame, and bless those here to support their induction. We also ask to bless all present and future athletes at Waterloo Central School, and may they and all the inductees continue to set an example for student athletes. We join together to eat, come bless our conversations, supplement the food we share with your heavenly goodness, and unite us as one in your everlasting love. Amen. Our high school athletics can be a step towards success in life. The pictures from these plaques, your pictures, are in the high school in the lobby, and we're almost running out of room. We're going to have to build a couple more walls to do something, but they're there from 1993 on. The flag you see out there in the lobby, that flag goes up in the gym. It's a pretty nice gym, if you haven't seen it. A little bigger than Main Street School. And it doesn't have a balcony, but it's pretty neat. Also, to give today's athletes a connection to the past, and give our inductees a connection to Waterloo Athletics for the future, please visit. When you're in town, go to a game. Some teams are good, some teams are not so good, but that's the way it is. And to develop a bond of loyalty over time. And we hope through this that we're fostering that. I do want to mention that in our tradition, that we do mention from our last Hall of Fame, this one, Hall of Fame inductees who have passed away. One just recently was Dave Bowman from the 1962 football team and 63, but the 62 team was inducted. And I'm very happy to have his wife here tonight. So, very happy. Others that two people from the 50s, Chuck Yost, longtime Waterloo policeman. And he died in this past year and a half. And Gail Oyler just died recently. Here's a 1953 graduate of Waterloo and pretty darn good basketball player. He lived out in the state of Texas. And then, two other iconic figures from the 60s. On August 31st, Bill Carey died. Your coach. My mentor. He was 95 years old. He was a week away from being 96. He attended these regularly. I can always remember him attending our basketball or baseball games when I was coaching. And the other one just recently was Mike Ornato, who died at the age of 89 on February 10th this past year. And as you see in this booklet, and there are some others you can pick up, we have a few things that are being said about both of them. So I'd like to address all that, and just give me a moment of silence to those people. Thank you. To begin, our inductees, I'm going to introduce committee member Adam McMahon, class of 1998 athlete at Waterloo, and a member of the Waterloo Hall of Fame. Adam?
He was a very good lacrosse player. I know less about lacrosse, Fun fact, he was the best baseball player in his class. He was a great pitcher and catcher, who made that group of baseball players sectional championship contenders. This coach may or may not have asked you to hit a batter in an all-star tournament. He did miss the kid all four times, but the end result was there. He got on first base, and he didn't get a hit. He did say he may not remember that. But he went on to say that Josh is the best athlete that he personally coached in Waterloo, and he did everything for him. So I thought you want to hear that from a former coach. Chuck Manuel, so I'm Chris. So again, congratulations. It's my honor to introduce you as the next member of Waterloo Athletic Hall of Fame.
Being late to every practice my sophomore year because of Gordon Lauer up there, also known as Iron Man Lauer. That's a stage name. He was my ride. He was 2 years older than me. I'm still late for every kind of event that I've ever attended. My wife loves it. Billy Jolly for coming in the huddle. He was a quarterback back in the day, and he always be like, hey, what was that play? You know, like, stop messing around, just give me the ball. You know, you know, I still play basketball every Tuesday. Tim used to play for a while, he quit. I don't know why, but I think he started having some legs issues. Still, right after Marlow High School, you know, I see all the Hall of Famer names up on the wall. I've been waiting for years to get my name hung up on the wall. I think it's 17 years. So, Mr. Pizzato, if you picked any other weeks leading up to that, leading up to the ceremony, but informed me when I was out in the hospital with my son Asher that was pretty much the best week of my life. You know, he informed me that I was going to be inducted in the Hall of Fame, and that week was very special for me. Thank you all for attending and appreciate everyone's kind words. Have a good night.
She's also still listed at least four times in the Cuba College school records I honestly started to lose track of them, but I believe they were number of assists in a game, number of assists in a season, not once but twice, and free throw percentages. Courtney rounded out her college career playing two more years of varsity basketball at Division III Alfred University. Professionally, Courtney is an account executive for Bright, an IT and cybersecurity company in Victor, New York, and she resides in Rochester with her significant other, Billy Whitney. Courtney, I don't know what took us so long, but we're glad you're here tonight. Please join me in welcoming Courtney Lincoln, class of 2007, into the Waterloo Hall of Fame.
So I think I have it down to 14 now. So we've added 2 minutes on to it. So, you know, I'm not sure how long, you know, it took a long time to get me here, but I'm thankful and blessed to be part of this process and this committee. I'm a 2011 member of the Hall of Fame. So I know the importance of individual sports and how sometimes they go, you know, unrecognized and overlooked. Usually it's a family affair. Mike and his parents are no exception. So when I thought about this, you can read the accolades, I reached out to Michael's dad. I reflected on the February 9th, 2012 induction letter, and it said Michael's golf career was established at the high school level and has been used as a building block for his lifetime accomplishments. So I called his father and about 2 weeks ago, and I said, talk to me about Michael. And he remembers Michael got the hook to play golf, and he's never looked back. He was 5 or 6 years old. He remembers traveling to summer tournaments all over New York State, Syracuse particularly. His mother and he were watching their son play. You know, but what stood out the most, his father said he was a good kid. He was never a problem with his attitude. He played by the best rules. His hat was always forward. His shirt was always tucked in. He said Michael is now 40 years old. And he still has never been a problem. He's a great son, a great husband, a great father. There are no alarming or overly funny stories like broken windows, things inside the cars, just a few marks on the side of the house and the garage doors, which Michael has confirmed that those did happen. But golf opened up so many doors for his son, he said, John Hopkins, LSU, and now the Ohio State University. He's a good son. Then I spoke with Michael, the 2013 St. John Fisher College Hall of Famer. He remembers playing as an eighth grader on the varsity, the pressure of being a freshman in the number one spot. He talked about his teammates like R.J. Ellison, shooting a 31 or 32 against Phil Mack and winning the match by one stroke and the pressure that created on his teammate, not himself. He carried the weight of his shoulders on his teams, being the top spot. We talked about the mental aspect of the game. I asked him, did you ever worry about the last shot? And he said, you know, I embrace the last shot. I learned from the bad ones and focus on the next one. I never worried about that last shot. Michael is humble. He talked about the greats before him, Nick Serafino, Eddie Boudreau, his college teammates, and mostly about his family, his wife, his son Bennett. He is grateful his parents exposed him to a lifetime of sport, a great game. He was grateful that he had a good coach and mentor in Dave Miller. I could go on and on and on. And it comes down to a few things. Why we're here. At Waterloo, he was a 2002 Dick Millmeyer Award winner, a two-time state representative to New York State Public High School Athletic Association Championships in 2001 and 2002. He was a Finger Lakes Conference champion in the fall of 2001. And he was the first Section 5 champion in golf. And if you live outside of Monroe County, we always love feeding those Monroe County kids. So last, he is humble, he is grateful, and now he is a member of the Waterloo Athletic Hall of Fame. Congratulations, Mike Stathis.
But she's here. And then Obviously not my dad. They really did expose me to something that I love. They did both. In 2013, I was inducted into St. John Fisher's Hall of Fame, and none of the other honorees played their game. They put their shoulder pads on for the last time. Didn't pitch a softball game thing for 4 years old, and still playing a game I love. This is why I don't vote speak also. You know, my job actually is to sit in front of strangers and talk about giving and supporting. I hate this part of it. I remember the first club my dad made in the garage, and we had a tree in the backyard. We just hit balls there for hours. And I also remember learning one morning that there were 2 4:30s every day. 4:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Because we were in the car at 4:30 a.m. to drive to Syracuse for a 7:30 tea time for the return. I would hopefully do that one day for a minute, but it was great. Reflecting back on some of my accolades from high school, there were some tough drives home. Making the league tournament, finishing almost last that first year, sectionals at Oquito, almost finishing last that year, and then coming back the next year and winning just made me better as I moved on and moved through college and eventually played professionally. And while it didn't work out all that great, I think I had a good amateur career and I hope to continue that. I think this would be the first time my wife and I had come back to Waterloo in about 2 years. We don't come back all that often. But there's something that I appreciate a small town, and that's an eighth grader's opportunity to play golf at a varsity level and to do something that I love, play a game that I love. And it's actually been pretty nice coming back, seeing like Coach Nolan. Haven't seen you in 20 years. I really appreciate everybody coming out tonight and seeing me be like this. I hate all the tweaking, and I totally admit it, but I am very honored. Thank you.
Does with kids with mental health, social and emotional learning. She's become a good friend of mine. And there's no better athletic director in the state. I'm the principal's director of Section 5 Athletics at the New York State Public High School Athletic Association. And I had the honor of about a year ago writing a recommendation for her for Section 5 Athletic Director of the Year. And she's very deserving, very rewarding. She does this for kids. And she is a leader, and she's building the next generation of Hall of Famers. So, Crystal, it is an honor to be in your presence.
Would you introduce some the Lufarelli family? A Hall of Fame committee member, longtime committee member, former commander of the Waterloo VFW, Mr. Chuck Nightingale.
The 60s in Waterloo was a wonderful time. Our teams were loaded with many gifted athletes. One of those was Lewis Gurley. He was a three-sport athlete wearing four varsity letters. He played 2 years of basketball, 2 years of varsity baseball. He played football for 4 years. As a senior, he was a two-way starter for Waterloo, first undefeated football team that defeated Niners for the first time in about 11 years. He was named to the Wayne Finger Lakes All-Conference team as an offensive guard and as a defensive linebacker. In 1962, he was the recipient of the Patchett Award, honoring him as the team's Defensive Player of the Year. On to college, 2 years of junior college football, and then 2 years of football at the University of Nebraska at Omaha. There, he was named the outstanding defensive player in both years he played. He earned a master's degree and an administrative degree from Rollins College in Winter Park, Florida. He taught junior high and senior high phys ed for 35 years at Oak Ridge High School in Orlando, Florida. As the school's head football coach, he led four teams to undefeated seasons. Those teams were also the county champions. He has a distinction of having coached seven former players who have played in the NFL. He's a college baseball umpire for 22 years. He was inducted into the Oak Ridge High School Hall of Fame and the Metro Conference Hall of Fame. Lou and his wife, Elaine, live in Orlando, Florida, and are the parents of sons Joseph, Jeffrey, and a daughter, Kathy. Lou is not able to be here tonight as he recently suffered a heart attack and had open heart surgery, as you heard earlier. Here you accept his award tonight is his nephew, Paul Wagner. Congratulations, Lou. Get better soon. Lou,
short speech. That was exactly what I had too. I guess I took right from your notes in the paper.
Oh,
okay. So, you know, Lou really had been looking forward to this. Gosh, you think you waited a while? My uncle waited 61 years. So he didn't wait too long. But, when my uncle got the word that he was nominated for this, it was amazing to see him light up, man. He was so happy. He's like, "You're going, right?" I'm like, "Yes, I'm going. I'm going. Don't worry, I'll be there." And we have an entourage of about 10 scheduled to come here, and of course that happened. He's doing great now. I got word today he got moved out of the ER. He's in his own room. He'll be in ICU rehab for a while, but he is really looking forward to coming back here next year and seeing all you guys and being, now he'll be here as a Hall of Famer, so. One thing he wanted me to point out, just a couple other things. You know, he mentioned he had been, other things he did in Orlando, he was an umpire for 22 years, and the year that the college Major League Baseball guys went on strike, he got to do Major League Baseball games. So, actually, umpiring for the New York Yankees was a dream come true, because he loves the Yankees. Mentioned that he was a Hall of Fame coach down in Orlando. 176 wins, 81 losses in his career. So I think now he got inducted to that first Waterloo High School team that went undefeated. So he's now a two-time Hall of Famer here at Waterloo. Two times down in Orlando. So, you know, he's just very excited, very honored to be, wish he could be here, but very honored to win this award and wanted to thank everybody, the committee, especially Chuck here. He wanted me to big special thanks to you for pushing him, and you know, thank you very much. It really made this year. Thank you.
it's my honor to present the plaques and some stories about the 1963, 64, and 65 Section 5 basketball champions. I started off as directed by Mr. Cochran. Now, this is a letter from Tom that I'm going to read to you. It is with immense pride and admiration I send my congratulations to Coach Tim Lincoln, Lou Ferrello, Mike Stackus, Courtney Lincoln, Josh Mateo, the 1980 girls cross country team, and the Section 5 Class A champion boys basketball teams. Congratulations on your enshrinement. I want to pay special tribute to the 63 and 64 teams. It was an honor and privilege to play with you, to forge lifelong friendships, and to work together to become a winning team. I also need to tip my cap to Lou Ferrelli, who was part of our 62 undefeated football team. We had nicknamed him Sam Huff, who played for the New York Giants, and during my time as head coach for the Giants, I always thought of Lou and chuckled when I would run in and talk with Sam Huff. Being recognized and inducted into any Hall of Fame is a momentous milestone, one that highlights your outstanding talents and the impact you have made within the community. But Waterloo High School sports would not have been the same without two exceptional individuals. Bill Carey was the ultimate role model, mentor, and Tom's personal inspiration for becoming a coach. His guidance led him to the Rochester Institute of Technology, where he began his coaching career. Bill dedicated decades to shaping young athletes during their formidable times and making them outstanding human beings. Under his leadership, the Waterloo baseball team won two Section 5 titles, and the basketball team secured three. He instilled in countless players the values of teamwork, discipline, and perseverance, lessons that extend far beyond sports. Similarly, Mike Arnato's career is a testament to his dedication and excellence in developing young athletes. He was only 26 years old when he began coaching the Waterloo High School football team, but it didn't take long to figure out that he was an old school coach who cared deeply about his players. I was honored to play for him during his high school career and then in my adult life to call him a friend. Bill and Mike are the giants upon whose shoulders so many of us stood and why the Hall of Fame is so important. The institution serves as a repository of our shared history, preserving the stories and legacies of those who made enduring contributions to our school. However, preserving this history requires support from everyone gathered here this evening. When we invest in our past, we honor our future, ensuring generations can come learn and be inspired by the remarkable individuals whose shoulders they stand upon. Tonight, let us celebrate this incredible group of inductees and honor the memory of those who came before by keeping their stories alive. Tom Coughlin, I thank him for writing the letter, and I thought you might like to hear that first. Now, a little bit about these teams. Up to 1963, there were only two small schools in the entire Section 5 that ever won three titles. One was Class D Hemlock, which doesn't exist anymore. And another Class C school, which, to be honest with you, even I forgot. Waterloo became the first large school to ever set three sectional titles in a row. We were Class A. The highest classification back in those days was Double A. In 1962-63, that team had a 13-1 league record, sole possession of first place in the Wayne Finger Lakes League, and they were 15-3 going into the sectionals before they beat Trumansburg and Arcade, remember that name, Arcade, in the quarterfinals and semifinals. Then came the 58-52 upset of 21-0 Leroy High School to give Waterloo its second overall title. They had won in 1957. That group was hammered, well, I think, the last time they won. Nine different people started games that year. Millen, McFreddy, Kelsey, Conklin, Kidd, Sitterly, Baldwin, Barry, and Chuck High. Juniors on that team, Bill Roush, Pete Marino, and John Hilker, contributed. Ken Sitterly was named first team All-League. He would go on to set a Waterloo record over the past, over his 3 years, of 61 straight starts in 3 years, ending with the 1964 championship. After somebody left the team, Don Barry was elevated from JV status to play the last third of the season and average double figures. Barry would be the only player who played on all three championship teams and in all nine sectional games. Dave Millen would end his senior year with 23 of the team's 55 points in the semifinals against Arcady, and then scored 16 in the finals against the Lord. Gap was the key. Even his injuries and illness took toll as the Indians captured that sectional without second leading scorer Tom Coughlin. 1964, packed with veterans, this team amassed a 17-3 record, just finishing behind first place Lions. I remember the game where Santelli made the two steals, and I don't know if anybody ever filled Waterloo High School or a gym like that again. But remember that game? And it was a tough loss. During that year, they did beat Miners twice. Starter John Hilker in the first game scored 11 points and a 63-52 win. Sid had 16 in a narrow 58-56 win at the end of the season. But in the sectionals, they just rolled. Sitterly, Coughlin, Baldwin, Kidd, and Barry were the regular starters, but a good match with John Hilker, Goodman, Somerville, Kingston, and an upcoming junior class gave Waterloo large victories. Carey became known around the Rochester area as a man of strategy. He was known for a few other things. You never knew when he was going to play man-to-man. You never knew when he was going to play 2-3. You never knew when he was going to play 1-3-1. He varied matchups. Baldwin could be the point guard one game, Kidd could be the forward, and they could switch, as they did on an opening 71-44 round of Bath. They defeated, there's his name again, Arcade, with Tom Coughlin as high scorer in the semifinals, and then beat undefeated Wayne 55-36 in a no contest game in the finals. 64-65 is a little different. Everybody graduated. The juniors coming back had Don Barry with them, and now Waterloo was thought to be to rebuild. They were not the preseason favorites for the first time in 3 years. But Gale Hayes, Jim Pratz, Howard Bateman returned. Chuck Trickler moved up in the JVs. And this guard named Jim Lynch took the lead by storm as the playmaker and became Bill's point guard. And for us to know, that was a tremendous adjustment for Bill, because Jimmy was a good player and his old player. It reminds me, later on in life, when I had a kid named Kevin Smith who led the league in scoring, and I could say, hey, nice shot, it's okay. You know, that was really, really a very well-blended team. His playmaking ability and scoring helped mold that team to its 17-4 record. Strong reserves, Phil Asprey, Tom Cox, Larry Hilmer, and Larry Jenkins contributed to the best defensive team in Section 5 Class A. Hillmeyer and Jenkins were to both end up playing for Bill Carey and RIT. The first game of the season, a doubleheader in the War Memorial. Waterloo versus Spencerport, East Rochester versus Lions. Class A, Class AA. No county teams ever got to go play in the War Memorial. But Waterloo and Lions had something special. In front of 9,000 people, Waterloo beat Spencerport 52-41, rolled over Palmyra 62-44 in the semis, and then, just for kicks, beat Arcade 61-50 in the finals. I got to know Tom Pope, the coach of those teams, who said the best thing that ever happened is all you people graduated. Waterloo didn't make the tournament the following year, and Arcade won. They didn't have the players. As I read your name, I would like you to come forward. First of all, I'd like to have Adam and Dave come up. They will present the plaques. If you just raise your hand and you want them to bring the plaque to you, there is no problem doing that. Afterwards, we're going to hear from Jack Kidd, who is my resident speaker every time you guys get together. Okay. It's in the order I'm going to. Accepting for Bob Baldwin. Here is Bob Baldwin Jr. and Shelley Baldwin. Please come up. Make sure Dupre gets a shot at this. By the way, we are filming this to put on YouTube so people like Louie and a few others that couldn't make it tonight can see this. So I want to thank Dupre Video for that. Representing Tom Coughlin, Carol Kingston, Tom's sister. To represent Gary Goodman. No, he's here. Gary Goodman, come on up, please. From Williamsburg, Virginia, John Hilkert.
Kent State in Ohio, and we're meeting some of the new kids coming in. And somebody said, I'd like you to meet Jack Morbido. And this little girl says, you? You're Jack Morbido? I said, yeah. She says, you can't imagine how we hated you. I'm from Lyons. And, oh, by the way, where's that chubby guy you were always with?
Representing Pete Moreno, who's home ill, Jefferson Elisafin. Well-known player and teacher at Waterloo for many years, and golf coach, Dave Melman. Kingston. This guy unfortunately called this morning and was ill, but I want to mention him because he had a couple people coming and he paid tickets. Gail Hayes. Gail Hayes in Waterloo. From North Pennsylvania, Jim Pratz.
Winner.
surgery, but we want to recognize Larry Hillmeyer. From Geneva, New York, Larry Jenkins. Representing the late Jim Lynch, Patty Art, Jim's sister. And representing Chuck Trickler, his son, Jeff Trickler. Jack Kidd would come forward. We already heard from Jim Pratt. If Jack Kidd would come forward to say a few words, I'd appreciate it.
Remember, Jack, tell them. We're the Waterloo Indians.
So I want to spend a couple of minutes about what I know about Joe Spazzato. How old were you when you were the bad boy?
Eight
years old. Ran into Joe Spazzato when he was 8 years old. He was the bad boy on the baseball team. Sort of. He was a member of the baseball team because he'd brag on the pitcher just like we would. And if you wanted to talk about sports, he knew more than all of us at 8 years old. He loves sports. Next thing you know, he's running all the sports, you know, he's coaching and all that stuff. It makes a lot of sense. But the thing is, look at all the people here that he has arranged for this kind of thing. He had built this thing up, and here we all are, with one of the more impressive gatherings I've seen in this full of seven. So congratulations to you. Well, as far as the basketball goes, the stories that you wrote and all that stuff are much better than what I can describe. I don't remember about them. There were highlights, and what I remember was that we all kind of grew up together. That was more important. That, you know, we all played all kinds of sports together. We were friends first, teammates pretty much second. And whatever needed to be done, we all kind of, I remember Kerry being an excellent coach, certainly. He and I disagreed on a number of things. I didn't think we needed a coach. You mentioned earlier, and this is the way it was. I was a rebounder in my junior year, and to testify to that, every 3 or 4 weeks, I would be carried off the court after stepping on somebody's foot with a sprained ankle. And I did score maybe 4 points a game. The next year, I did the same kind of thing, and I said, this is baloney. I never get my name in the paper unless I strain my ankle. I started practicing afterwards. I go, I'm going to be a shooter. I'm going to do this. That's how I do it. And so then Kerry noticed that. And then you had mentioned Bob Baldwin was outside. And so he said, switch. And I was able to score all these points. And Bob never said a word. He never complained. He was fine because we were all friends. The other thing, there's another highlight, which became very well known. Somebody stole Melty's bronze shoes, apparently, after the first win. His shoes looked like a car that had been hit by a truck. I mean, did you have a tape? These were disgusting sneakers. Win the sectionals, he throws them up in the air, they land. Somebody picks them up. Who was it? The next thing you know, they bronzed his sneakers. And they were in a trophy case for years and years. Partly because he had overcome, along with Timmy Young's overcome, being run over by a drunk driver at a younger age. And he couldn't play certain sports, but he had overcome that and scored. And he was successful on the basketball court and other things. So, and Timmy is too. There he is over there. So that was one of the highlights. And that, I was in college, and people asked me, were those your shoes? I said, no. Well, how did you know about this stuff? You know, because it was a legendary kind of thing that everybody knew about. The other thing that was a highlight was, well, how much time? 10 seconds, all right. So, there's a story about Tom, but I'll have to tell you later. The other thing was that when we were juniors, in junior year, we started dunking the ball during warm-ups. We used to jump off, and Junior and I jump off these mats on the wall and dunk the ball, and then I learned to use the floor, so I started dunking the ball. Gary, Spider, I saw you dunking the ball later on. And of course, Don was my dunking buddy throughout high school. The next year, I'm going to where they won again. Ozzy, I was playing with guys, lots of finals. Ozzy's standing there saying, look at the referees. And I said, what's, and I saw it. The referees are standing, here's this one, looking at this, on each side of the court, watching these players. I said, what's the problem? He says, they got to make sure they don't dunk the ball during the warm-ups. So I said, yeah, we bet. We were bad. We're bad. We're all lost. I'm very excited about that. But I still am, as you can tell. And of course, the people were always fun. So anyway, I'm sorry. Somebody stole your shoes. Anyway, so congratulations to you.
Stacey Evans to do the girls cross country team.
Okay, I'm back to introduce the next team of inductees, the 1980 girls cross country team. The 1980 girls cross country team was the first Section 5 championship team in the history of Waterloo High School for cross country. The talented Lady Indians were coached by Mr. Ed Courtney and began their historic journey in the fall of 1980 by capturing the Wayne Finger Lakes title with a record of 10 wins and only one loss. The team continued their success by winning the Section 5 Class B Championship, which qualified them to compete in the New York State's championship meet. This was a first for a Waterloo team. The Lady Indians proved to be fierce competitors. Led by Vicki Brown's 7th place finish in the state meet, the team captured 4th place, slightly behind Pearl River, Summers, and Williamsville North. Vicki Brown was Section 5's race winner that year and finished just ahead of Desi Burgos, who was the individual champion in 1979. These dedicated Lady Indians set high standards for themselves, to which Waterloo Cross Country Program has been held since they started this in 1980. So it's an honor for me tonight to be presenting this award to the women on behalf of the teenage girls they were when they earned this award 44 cross country seasons ago. And the teammates who have joined us tonight, please come up when I call your name, and if you feel comfortable, you can stay up here, and then I believe Linda is going to say a few words. Desi Burgos. Michelle Clear. Dorothy Dyson. Linda Gwinski. Tracy Ireland. Val Jolly. Tammy Morocco.
I'll just say I'll go behind Desi because I always fall behind her.
That wasn't true. We were all team. And that's what I wanted to say. I wanted to say that unfortunately Mr. Courtney's not here, but he used to call us the Thoroughbreds. And he was recruiting me in eighth grade. And I just moved to Waterloo in seventh grade. So, I mean, this guy was a maniac when it came to the ladies' cross country team. So I just want to give him a round of applause. Worked hard, and I mean, right up to the finish line, we had to have that last kick, and we had to have that, you know, first out of the gate, and it was just amazing. I just appreciate that you never let it be. Thank you so much. And Tim, and everybody else, also personally, Tim Youngs, who used to get me up at 5 a.m. on Nick Devo running all summer long, the marathon man.
I'm like you, I'm not a public speaker, and I'll get this out of the way real fast with, I've been blessed with a lot of things in my life, and I've inherited a lot of things from my mother and my father, one of which is a familial essential head tremor. So there's nothing wrong with me, my head just tremors, and I inherited that from my mother. So good evening, honored guests, athletes, coaches, and supporters. Tonight we gather to celebrate excellence, dedication, and the indomitable spirit of our high school athletic community. On behalf of our entire team, I would like to thank the Athletic Hall of Fame for awarding us this honor, specifically Mr. Spizzato, Tim Lincoln, and Stacey Evans for organizing everything, and the other board members. Your ongoing dedication to recognizing individuals and teams is deeply appreciated. during my and our collective high school running careers, specifically referencing cross country, we had several different coaches over the years. First on my list is my father, Bill Glinsby, my greatest cheerleader. Mr. Courtney, whose infectious joy always made us laugh, even through the most brutal hill running workouts. We know him. He always told us to go out and just have fun. Mr. G, whose humble presence and constant encouragement was just what we may needed at times. And Mr. Donnelly, who pounded the pavement with us almost every day, pushing us to be better than we were. We thank each of you for your commitment, constant encouragement, understanding, and empathy. So much has changed in the past 44 years. One change that I notice often is my physical prowess. My knees remind me of it every day. They have a lot of mileage on them. In 2022, I underwent knee surgery, just arthroscopic on my right knee. Typically, when I see a medical professional, they always say to me, gosh, your heart rate's really low, or you must be an athlete, or something to that effect. And I always respond, oh, I've been a runner all of my life. So back in 22, fast forward, and I went in to have the knee surgery, and when it comes to blood, I get a little bit squeamish. And so the nurse had a hard time getting the IV into my arm, and I, of course, passed out. So they went into a tizzy in the operating room. Everybody who came into that room after they got me stabilized, they were really concerned. They would say, gosh, your heart rate's really low. And I was feeling really good. And I said, well, it's because I've been a runner all of my life. So my wife, Amy, finally comes into the room. And I said, hey, did you know I've been a runner all of my life? So it's a running joke, no pun intended, between all of us to say, I've just been a runner all of my life. I know how being part of a team in this sport has changed me, and I suspect shaped my team members. This was a place for us to build confidence, eloquence, discipline, grace, tenacity, and friendships. Experience is where we could learn about ourselves on those long, slow runs, pushing ourselves up one more hill, or running in line where the last runner had to sprint past the line to the front of the line over and over, mile after mile. The greatest lesson is this. Cross country is both a team sport and an individual sport. A team places together overall, and each individual runner places. Everyone's running the same path and shares a very common experience. With that experience comes empathy. Our ability to sense other people's emotions, coupled with the ability to imagine or know what someone else might be thinking or feeling. Having empathy enables us to build social connections. To feel connected to others is hugely important to our optimal well-being. It is the very basis of human relationships and helps us to feel valued, loved, and cared for. To do this, we have to get in touch with our own emotions. Brené Brown said, empathy heals another at exactly the same time it is healing me. It is connecting to the emotions that underpin an experience. This is the true essence of participating on a cross-country team. Tonight, I honor each of you for your outstanding achievements as we navigate the complexities of our world today, 44 years later. Let us remember the power of empathy to heal, unite, and to inspire future generations of young girls and boys towards achieving their athletic dreams and goals. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I kept the anchor man to last. I'm here to honor Tim Lincoln. Tim Lincoln was hired as the Waterloo Central School District Analyst in 1995 and began a coaching career at that time. He was put on the staff, the girls basketball staff, of head coach Tom Benetti, and for the next 7 years served as an assistant in that realm. He became the girls head basketball coach from 2002 to 2009, came back later in 2015 to 2018. His 2003 to 2006 teams won 34 straight league basketball games, 6 Finger Lakes League East titles, the 2005 sectional title, which took them all the way to the second appearance for our girls in the New York State Finals. And then in 2007, he came back and won the sectionals again. He was an assistant coach also in volleyball, softball, and soccer, those first two very ordinary programs. He was an integral part of many of my adventures, captain's workshops, basketball tip-off tournaments, exceptional senior games, when we put in concussion management, one of the first schools here to do so. Program helped run the New York State softball tournament, which we ran in 2009 and 2010. And of late, served on the Village DRI committee with me on the $10 million grant we just got for the Village of Waterloo downtown area. He is a man of all trades, and he is a leader of all leaders. He's a Section 5 girls basketball chair. He is the New York State girls basketball tournament chair, won many awards in Chapter 5 of the state, and this past year became the 7th Waterloo person to be inducted into the Section 5 Basketball Hall of Fame. I welcome to the Waterloo Hall of Fame my friend, Tim Lincoln.
I will keep this brief. Josh, you know, you waited 17 years. This is the second time that I've had to wait to last for the Hall of Fame induction speech. Thanks a lot, Joe. I really appreciate it. I'm glad you were nice to me today, because I said to him earlier this week, I said, Joe, don't forget who gets to go last on Sunday. Thank you. I would like to congratulate the individual inductees and the 4 teams that have been inducted tonight. I am extremely humbled and honored to be standing in front of you, and I would have never dreamed when I started this journey 29 years ago as an unpaid volunteer assistant coach I would achieve this honor. There are many people that I need to thank, and without all of them, I would not be here tonight. First, as Joe mentioned, my high school basketball and baseball coach, Tom Benetti, who in 1995 asked me to be his unpaid volunteer assistant coach. Oh, what a year we had, right, Coach? We were 1-20. Won 1 game over Christmas break. Boy, Coach, you started this entire mess. I blame you for everything. To all my players over the years, thank you, for without you, none of this would be possible. The players either loved or hated me. What I tried to instill in them was not only athletic knowledge, but also life lessons. Whether it was the quote of the day, being on time, which is 15 minutes early, right, Tom Coughlin? Accountability in the classroom and respect for your teammates in the sports that I was currently coaching. I think I was tough but fair, made them work hard and guided them to a common goal, and held them accountable even when they did not want to be. To my assistant coaches, Nick Newman, Dan Belt, and Jack O'Connor, thank you for your wisdom and your support. As I reflect on my high school academic years, I cannot help to realize how fortunate I was to be coached or mentored by many, many role models. Fellow Hall of Famers, Harry Schwartz, Ed Courtney, Jim Anderson, and Tom Benetti. All coached me at various times during my athletic career or influenced me in the classroom. Words cannot express the feelings I have when I think about the impact these men had on my young life, along with others like Scott Reed, my JV baseball coach, and Bill Boyce, my high school band teacher, who taught me how to have a balance between athletics and the arts. These men, along with the community of Waterloo, will help mold me to the man I am today, and I hope that I have made them proud. And finally, Joe Spazzato. What can I say? Thank you for not only being my freshman basketball coach and JV football coach almost 50 years ago, but also for being my basketball mentor, sharing your coaching philosophy and basketball wisdom and your insight into the inner workings of Section 5. And always finding another project for us to work on, but most importantly, being my friend. You, along with Tom Benetti, were instrumental in teaching me the correct way of communicating with officials during basketball games. Too bad Mike Ferraro left, because I'd added into that mix as well. Joe, I have truly valued our friendship for the past 29 years. Thanks to the 2006-2007 sectional basketball team led by my daughter Courtney, we were elite champs, Section 5 champs, lost to the eventual state champs, East Aurora, in the regionals, and in the sectional finals, Courtney led the way with 33 points, going 15 for 19 from the free throw line, and was named Class Double B Tournament MVP. The 2004-2005 state finalist team, thank you, what a ride it was. We finished the season 22-4, losing to Mercy Nazareth twice and eventual state champion John Glenn Elwood. As I reflect on that sectional final game against Nazareth, there are vivid memories for me. How loose the team was during the morning shoot-around while the coaches were very nervous. The execution of the coach's game plan to a T, starting with a hard screen on Nazareth's best defender during our first offensive set, which set the tone for the game. To Selena Santel's half-court three-point shot that put us up 15 points at the end of the third quarter, and having four players, Selena Santel, Vanessa Jane, Allison Colton, and Courtney Lincoln, named to the all-tournament team, while Nazareth's Nicole Jones was named to the tournament MVP. Those four kids did not care about the MVP award. They had a more important trophy. That team was truly a team. And that night, that team proved that team chemistry was far more important than talent. Thanks to my family. And I want to say a special thank you to my two grandsons who have been here today, putting up with Papa for two speeches, and my great niece Ariana. Especially to my mother and father, who taught their three children at an early age to work hard, be dedicated and passionate about the things you love. Thanks, Mom, for being here tonight. And I know Dad is smiling down from heaven. To my sister, Kathy, the second strongest woman I know, whose bright smile and golden heart will be missed as we lost her to cancer this past Monday. Thank you to her family, my brother-in-law, Bill, my niece, Erin, and my nephew, Michael Stevens, for making her as comfortable as she could for last week and being here tonight through this tough time. All of us find comfort knowing that she and Dad are together again. To my brother Ed, you drove my competitive fire. Thank you. I will never forget all the competitions that we had, especially in the newspaper sword fights. In the living room where we used to beat the snot out of each other. And if I was somehow getting beat, I would always say, hang on a second, Ed, I need to tie my socks in order to get the upper hand on me. To my daughters, Kate and Courtney, I know there were times playing for your father was difficult, but your talents on the athletic field always shine through, and I'm proud of the women you have both become, and I'm grateful to join you in the Waterloo Athletic Hall of Fame. Now we just need to work on slow to get your mother adopted. To my wife, thank you. This honor is as much yours as it is mine. Thank you for being by my side for the past 29 years in marriage, just 2 days ago. 39 years. By the way, this is your anniversary dinner tonight. Joe, that seems to happen all the time when we do this time of year. Raising two beautiful daughters and supporting me as coach and coordinator for the past 29 years, so man, I love you. I am extremely grateful to have graduated from Waterloo and call Waterloo my home. There is no place that I would rather be right here, right now, because Waterloo, you are the dearest, you are the sweetest in memory. When in every years I wander, I will never think of thee. I see your amber flowing o'er us, thee your angel black so true. They're the only colors everyone know, wonders in the high school of Waterloo.
Thank you very much.
Stay healthy, stay safe. God bless you all.